Hey everyone, we're going to take a quick break and talk about our sponsors for the month, AMP Agency. AMP is a full-service digital marketing agency that specializes in tour, rental, and destination marketing.
We would not have sponsors on the show if we could not vouch for them ourselves. AMP Agency does a bunch of stuff for Destiny Water Adventures. Personally, I 100% vouch for this guy. I've handed them over to other companies in the past before they officially became a sponsor, and they have had nothing but great things to say. If you guys are doing your own marketing and doing a piss poor job of it, do yourselves a favor, hand yourselves over to AMP Agency, specifically Steve Edwards, their CEO, will call you personally and have a great conversation with you about what you guys need to do for your marketing.
Listen, guys, they do pretty much everything in digital marketing. Website development, maintenance, Google AdWords, PPC, graphic design, social media management, SEO, and a myriad of other things. When you choose a marketing company, it's so important to choose a company that knows your industry. And AMP Agency knows activity marketing, especially water sports and tours. They got a promo going for Awkward Water Sport Guy listeners for their managed websites. Use promo code Awkward Podcast when you go to amp.agency. Again, that's amp.agency, promo code Awkward Podcast. You get 3 months free and get started with AMP Agency. All right, guys, let's get back to the show.
I'm recording. I just need to get some nuts.
Why don't you just set it up on a T-ball for me, buddy? I'll tell you what, I'm just going to leave that one alone, but I will say this, man. On the last episode, we had Steve Edwards talking about, you know, how things are soft. On this episode, we're joined by Justin Buzzi, and I'll tell you what, there's nothing soft in this room when this guy's on. Hey. Let's go.
Wow.
Go, man. So look, I'm not gonna try and steal like a lot of the airtime, but like I wanted to preface this episode before we get started, and then we'll do all the hey, how you doing. But last time Justin was on, man, like I just got to put it out there, I was like slightly intimidated by his success and what he's done and his career and his branding, and I talked a lot of shiz to him like in the beginning, and then I tried to like walk it back, and I always kind of felt like, man, I came across as a huge jerk to him, and I just want to apologize, dude, because that's it's not the environment I want to foster, bro. And it's just like, you know, I definitely am impressed by what you've done and what you built, and I think so highly of you, man, and I do really appreciate you coming back on this show, man, and talking to us, and welcome, man. Welcome.
Of course.
Welcome.
Thank you. Yeah, appreciate it. I'm excited to be back. I've listened to every episode. I'm up to date. I'm all caught up with everything AWG, so I always appreciate filling up my drives with some good info and really good industry people that you guys have had on and stuff. So I appreciate it. Yeah, thank you.
Hey, Justin, real quick, can you turn your gain down a little bit?
Is this better?
There goes Greg.
Yeah, there you go.
Okay.
Greg, why do we have to do this? You know, he's got this like great voice and he sounds so wonderful, and you just, I think there's a problem. Justin, we've already identified it. Greg is also jealous of you. He just hasn't come to terms with it.
Yeah.
Are you jealous of his voice?
No, I'm actually trying to make him sound better.
I think that's impossible.
Yeah. Greg, hey, I'll take what I can get.
How you doing, Greg? It's been like 30 seconds since I've talked to you. Let's pretend
great.
Like this is like brand new, and we don't just like shoot.
Now that Justin's on the show, I was telling Kevin earlier that, remember LimeWire?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So LimeWire turned into like some crypto NFT company, and they're doing an ICO, and they've raised $16 million. And I'm like, you know, maybe I'll throw $100 in and just see if it moons or something. I don't know, but it made me think of LimeWire when we got it, because you know you did your crypto thing. Are you still doing much with it?
Not right now. No, I've been kind of just chilling on it. I have a good amount of Ethereum still, which I'm thankful for. But I got hacked last year and just have been kind of chilling since that happened. And since my based Fish Mafia never went to the moon, I'm just kind of, you know, chilling.
Man,
I got 300 of them that never went to the moon. Yeah, a lot of fish. They went to the dumpster, and this year's they're going to be a tax write-off, hopefully, one day.
There you go. There you go.
I wonder if this year's Arival is going to have the same, like, you and Peter Simi or whatever is that Scottish guy's last name is talking about, like, NFTs. Like, we got to walk a few things back.
Like, well, it's going to be ChatGPT this year. Oh, yeah. It's all going to be about ChatGPT.
Yeah, and don't get me wrong. I mean, I love ChatGPT. We use it, man. But at the same point in time, like, I sort of feel like maybe just a little bit like the guys doing the cheese tour in New York City. You know what I mean? He spun up about a total of $18 to invest is, like, probably not, like, you know, sitting down at chat. Sometimes I think, like, we get so heady in this industry about things, you know, like, I don't know. It's just like everyone's such a lifestyle guy. Like, everybody did this, like, other than me, other than Justin, other than Greg. There's a few of us. But I think the most of the people in the industry started in this business to get away from sitting behind a computer. And I think it's like antithesis to a lot of guys. Like, the idea of doing it, even though I preach to the moon about having to do it, I think it becomes antithesis to what it is they want to do with their life. But not Justin, man. I mean, I see Justin's out there doing his thing, man. Dude, it's been, how long has it been since we had Jan? Like, that was the early days.
Yeah, I forget which episode that was, but I mean, that was probably close to a year ago, if I had to guess.
A year ago. Yeah.
More than a year ago. Yeah.
Yeah. So what have you been up to, dude?
Too much to keep up with. The beginning of this year has been crazy for me. I had an emergency ankle surgery. And then I had to get my appendix out like 2 weeks after my ankle surgery. So I spent a lot of time, horizontal, laying down, and been able to catch up, you know, catch up on some.
I was just waiting for Kevin.
Bet you did. You know, moved into a new house, and so a lot of changes, a lot of stuff going on. Had, you know, been opening new franchises, hired a new director of franchise operations, hired a new manager for my two locations that I still own, and just getting ready for the summer season right now, you know, hiring tour guides, making sure that we're fully staffed, that kind of thing. And it's been a busy first start of the year. I can't believe it's already, you know, May now, and time has just flown by this year.
So because we've talked about this a little bit, you know, and sort of a little bit of doom and gloom in the markets. Are any of your operators seeing that? Is any of your markets going, oh man, like, this year is not living up to last year?
Not yet. Thankfully, we have had like maybe a month where someone has gone down a little bit, but I think that's more related to weather than anything. The weather's been pretty crazy in some of our locations. We had red tide over in Tampa. We've had super high winds and like hailstorms over on the east coast of Florida, down south. And so overall, like, everyone has been up except for, you know, during those periods of time where I think the weather just hasn't really cooperated too much this year. But overall, I felt like it was a warm winter. And we kind of benefited from that, you know, being a little bit warmer than usual. And thankfully, yeah, we've seen growth across the board, which has been super helpful. And I'm super thankful for that.
Are you tired of spending countless hours managing your water sport and boat rental reservations manually? Is your current system outdated or doesn't provide the necessary features that your business requires? Hi, I'm Greg Fisher, the CEO of WaveRes, an online reservation software built by operators for operators. With our system, you can offer 24/7 online booking to your customers, allowing them to book and pay for their rentals at their convenience. You can also send SMS notifications to your customers, keeping them updated on their reservation status and any changes that may occur. Custom options and dynamic pricing enable you to offer tailored packages to your customers, helping you stand out from your competitor. Plus, our system integrates with companies like Werewolf Digital Waivers and TripShock, streamlining your operations and ensuring a seamless booking experience for your customers. Our software is the best choice for water sport and boat tour operators, as it is designed to cater specifically to your needs. So why waste any more time on manual reservation management? Try WaveRes today and take your business to the next level. For limited time, mention this ad and receive $100 credit when you sign up. Check out wavres.com for more info or to schedule a free demo. Now let's get back to the show.
What a did I tell you, Greg? Like at the end of the last episode, I said, look, man, like enough of this doom and gloom stuff. And then I did like a little rap. You can listen to it. But I was like, man, I want to bring on Justin Buzzi so we can feel a little warm and fuzzy. So I was like, that guy's going to have nothing but optimism for us, man. I'm like, thank God that's how we're finishing off, man. I'm really glad I set the schedule up the way I did, man. Cause I was like, man, I need some good news in my life. and to your point, man, I have to say that, while it hasn't been doom and gloom at Destiny because of those exact same things that you highlighted, you know, we've actually seen a very small amount of growth. There's a couple differing factors, but 100% everything you said, the reason we've seen that growth in Q1 is because of the wonderful weather that we had starting off January and February months, and then the drop off you see and lots of cancellations and that sort of thing is because the wackiness of the weather, man. It's like, if it's not cold, it's raining, apparently the last 2 months, you know, and it has been in North Florida, just incredibly chilly. So I think the people will come out, especially our drive-in market, when they start to see those Florida balmy summer days, that just, you know, they just really haven't been kickstarted yet. So I'm in a total agreement with you, man. And what else have you been doing on the personal side?
Kevin, he was 40 under 40, Orlando Business Journal. Let's talk about that.
So were you.
That's right. Greg was too. Let's go.
Yeah. not in Orlando. His is a bigger deal though. You know.
Come on.
Let's talk about him.
Oh my God, man. Go back into the last episode, you sad man. Oh, trying to make yourself. And look, I'm 50 under 50. No,
there we go. Soon you'll be, you know, 80 under 80. Yeah.
Yeah, but I look like I'm.
No.
Did you have to advertise in their journal to get that?
No, you.
And the reason why I ask, I reeked because that was the one when I got mine. That was the first question I asked because I get asked a lot. Oh, Greg Fisher, CEO, you've been selected to be top 30 under 4, whatever. And then I said, okay, well, what's the catch? I'm like, what do you mean, what's the catch? I said, there's got to be a catch to this. Like, you just randomly messaged me. Oh, you're just a travel guy. I'm like, fine, I'll read more. It's like, okay, you got to get a $500 magazine ad or whatever. But this guy actually is a magazine called Destined City Lifestyle, and they're like a franchise magazine. They're all over. But no, he's like, no. He's like, a lot of the people that did get the award, they are advertisers, but you don't have to. But, you know, he kind of said it in a way where, you know, you kind of have to do it. I ended up didn't do it because it didn't make sense. Like, I don't advertise in magazines. But it's – so you definitely are one to earn it. But I just – it's more of like a funny thing because you probably get the same thing.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no, we get it. We get those emails a lot. And, no, you don't have to advertise in there to do it. Obviously – after you get nominated for it, they try to give you that upsell. And I did opt to advertise in it because I think it's a good opportunity for me to push the personal brand a little bit and also potentially find qualified people to be franchisees. You know, this is a business journal. So I'm assuming the people that read it care a lot about business, and this could be a good market for them to be a franchisee. So it was kind of a good B2B move for me and for the personal brand. But in order to be on it, you do have to get nominated by someone. So shout out to my wife, Tia, for nominating me. because, yeah, they do it off of nominations. And, you know, that's one thing I'll say to people listening is there's a lot of things like this out there that you just have to go and find and try to be a part of. And it could help elevate your brand, your business brand, your personal brand, whatever it is. And so I think being a part of that has just been a good way for me to kind of like put a little stamp of approval on, you know, some of the work that I've accomplished over the last few years and be able to now leverage that title when I'm selling franchises or trying to expand the business or whatever it may be.
Hey guys, we're going to take a quick break to talk about the Watersports Forum, which is now being rebranded as the Port at
Arival.
That's right, Kevin. We're going to be doing our third annual Watersport and Boat Tour Operator Forum, now called The Port, from October 9th to the 12th. So let's break it down real fast. The first day, October 9th, is the full day event. Well, we're bringing speakers, host panels, do roundtable sessions. If you went to the year previous, you kind of understand the format. The rest of the week, we'll be partnering with the Arival Conference to bring you supplemental programming in our special VIP room called Captain's Cove.
Listen, I want you guys to hear me loud and clear. If you guys are listening to this show, if you guys have ever come to one of our conferences before and you thought that was great, this is going to be jam-packed with value. Now, I want to tell you one last thing. Somebody, a very smart investor, once told me that you bet on the jockey, not on the pony. So I'm asking you guys to bet on this conference, on Greg and myself, on Doug and Bruce at Arival, and know that the amount of value that you are going to extract from both of these conferences are going to be an incredible return on that investment.
So let's talk pricing. A one-day ticket for the forum will run $199. This also includes lunch and our after-hours event. If you decide to stay for the Arival Conference, you can purchase a combo ticket, which gives you a 15% discount on both events. Because the pricing goes up each month leading up to the event and this commercial doesn't change, please head to thewatersportpodcast.com and click on 2023 Conference. Again, watersportpodcast.com, click on the 2023 Conference link in the menu, and then you can view the current pricing for the combo package in the Arival ticket. You'll also find info on lodging and programming. This year, we're going to be having at the Rosen Shingle Creek, which is an awesome resort.
Special guest speakers. We're going to have a lineup that is going to knock your socks off. We're going to be covering everything from assets, finance, marketing, operations. Like, this is the one and done mastermind. And I don't know when we're going to be able to do something this comprehensive again. And I guarantee you, if we do, we'll be bringing the same value in a smaller group for 10 times the amount of money, because it really is that valuable.
Be sure to get your tickets early because you only have 125 seats. Again, watersportpodcast.com, go to 2023 Conference, and from there you can purchase your tickets, you can purchase your combo tickets, you can purchase your lodging. Everything you need to know about the conference is on that page. If you have any questions, just reach out to Kevin or myself, go to our Facebook group, hit us up. We'd be happy to answer anything you need, and we'll see you there. Let's get back to the show.
Hey, so I want to ask you something. You know, we kicked this episode off, me talking about how I was like in the show, I kind of like low key hated on you a little bit, like in a jokingly funny way. it was maybe harsh at some point, even, because I can't be that way. I always drop like a lot of these nuts jokes and like you can rub on my ball or some shit, like bullshit.
Speaking of these nuts, I tried to get him. Was it like a couple weeks ago? I tried to get you on a D's nut. Well, it was a different one. So,
yeah.
This is a really funny story because Kevin didn't fall for it, but maybe he almost did. I don't know.
No.
But, okay.
My kids don't fall for D's nuts.
Okay.
Jokes,
because
they're so prevalent in my house.
No, this is really good. So, somebody made a fake conference website called the SawCon Conference.
Oh my God.
Yeah. And you go to the website. If you're listening, go to the website, you're going to laugh. So anyways, I get in Kevin's DM and I said, hey, have you heard of the SawCon? Because we talk about conferences all the time.
DM, right?
I said, have you heard of the SawCon Conference? And I was waiting for him to say, what's the SawCon Conference? And I would say, SawCon these nuts, right? He goes to the website and he sees it and he gets the whole gag, right? And he's like, you're not going to get me on it. And then he turns around like the next day and says, hey, I need to go to Aldi. And he tried to turn it on me thinking that I know my D's nut jokes too. So he didn't get me.
I was driving by Aldi's at that point. I even sent him a picture and I saw the Aldi sign.
I know what you're trying to do. You're trying to stage it. I get it. But we were both 0-1. For it, okay. but it was so funny because you go to the SawCon website and like the main speaker is like Richard Head, you know, so it was like kind of a giveaway. It was hysterical though, but yeah, it was good.
Oh my God, I don't like. I know you do some editing. I just hope you edit that that little anecdote right out of the show.
Okay, well, I'm sorry, you were asking Justin something. Go ahead.
That's the worst episode ever. Yeah. So no, I mean, like, so my question is like, because you're such a positive guy, I have to assume that, like, you do get a little bit of hate from time to time. I mean, like, so we did the personal brand thing. You were up in, you had your ankle issue. I really wanted to, bring you on for that because you do such a good job on that. So, like, on the other side of it, like, what would you tell? So we all experience this in our industry, whether we know it or not, right, Justin? Like, if you're doing things right, you're going to have haters. And, I mean, how do you deal with that a little bit when you know people are either low key in the background, because you can sort of feel it when they are, or even overtly, like, you know what I mean, to your face or on your social media or talking shit to you on Facebook or something like that? Like, what's your process of dealing with some of that negativity?
Yeah. Like you said, I'm super positive. So I try not to let it affect me too much. You know, let it affect me personally too much. But I think, like, I look at it as kind of validation that I am doing the right things, because, you know, everyone's going to have something to say about something. If they didn't come up with it, if they weren't the first ones, if they weren't doing it right, they're going to be a little bitter about it. And I'm in the mindset of, like, there is enough people in this world for every single business to be successful. And there's like 8 billion people in the world. Why can't we all have businesses, have customers, make money, be happy? And so I feel bad for the people that are out there just saying negative things, doing negative things. Like, and it doesn't affect me. It just makes me feel bad for them, because, like, I know that they're probably not in as positive mind state as I am, and they've got an uphill battle. And, you know, that's their own journey. And my journey is just a completely different path than where they're going. And so that's up to them on how they want to, you know, look at someone that's maybe doing something a little bit better than they are or differently than they are. And, you know, I try not to let it affect me too much, but, yeah, there's always going to be people that are trying to copy what you do, that are copying what you do. Man, we've had people, like, copy and paste our entire policies and forget to erase "get up and go kayaking" out of the policies. You know,
you had some hate though recently. What? I would say maybe a competitor.
Oh, go ahead. Wait a minute. Greg, I don't know if he wants to talk about that publicly.
We can go a little bit into it. That's fine. Right. Yeah. Right. We can go surface level. Yeah, it's fine.
Cool, man. I didn't want to, that's why I didn't bring that up. Cause me and Justin kind of talked about that in the background a little bit, a couple months ago. And I, you know, just because of litigation, and this is all going to get edited out, Justin, unfortunately for Greg, but we'll edit this portion of it out. But he had sort of mentioned to me that he wasn't quite ready to talk about it. So if you're comfortable talking about it, like, that's why I was just keeping it, like, way at a top level. But if you're comfortable talking about it, then
yeah, you tell us what you want to tell us.
Yeah. So
yeah, I got
back
you
to that point. I mean, you know, and Justin, I know it's just, like, sort of one of those things where it's like, because you are so positive, I know you, like, roll stuff off your back and just keep plowing forward with doing you. But if you feel comfortable with talking about any particular situation, I mean, we're all ears, man.
Yeah. I mean, there's been, you know, several people that have literally just copied the business and, you know, used our photos, used similar branding. I had kids that I went to high school with that created a company called Go Clear Kayaking. Right down the street from one of our locations, and literally just, you know, copied all of the content on our website and just, like, changed a few words for themselves. The most recent one is someone that, like, will get a 1-star review for his own tour business, and then he'll respond to the review telling people that I set them up to leave that review. And, like, I told them to go leave a 1-star review on his business, and he'll, like, call me out by name in his response to them on TripAdvisor. And that bleeds into even his homepage on his website. He, like, talks about me and my business specifically. So, You know, just like navigating those things is kind of interesting. And
what if that was true, man? Like, what if in the background you're just this low key hater? You like, you flip around like your hat backwards. You're like, now it's time for Jay Buzzsaw to do some work, son. You're out there writing fake reviews. You're like plant, like sewing holes in people's fucking kayaks.
Right,
you know?
Right.
You're, like, just this huge internet troll in the background.
Yeah, imagine that, like that meme with Kermit the Frog, like typing madly. Like, it's Justin.
Yeah, because I have time to go leave a company that has very little customers a 1-star review, right? Like, it's funny, and like he calls us out for, you know, like he says that we have all fake reviews, and we have 21,000 reviews at this point, and that's a shit ton of reviews. Don't get me wrong, but none of them are fake. I mean, if I had 21,000 friends to all leave me a review, that'd be amazing. But I have 10 friends. I mean, you know, how many reviews could we leave here? And so, you know, it's funny to me that like people do these things and say these things online. And, but at the same time, it's never usually the people that show up to the events. It's never the people that are trying to grow their personal brand. It's never the people that are actually out there doing something. It's always the people that are lost. They don't know what to do.
You are the blame for everything.
Listen,
in their life.
Let me pull away from that and tell you the cause of something. At the last Watersport conference, soft plug, which is now going to be the port at Arival. If you haven't got tickets, early bird pricing is running out. At the last Watersport conference, Justin, anytime I see something, somebody ask a question on their marketing game and I am not doing what I think is a good idea, I'm like, gotta do that. But Justin asked, you know, he sort of did this poll, like, how many of you guys are doing, you know, daily content? It was like 10 pieces a month, 20 pieces a month, 30 pieces a month. And, you know, man, like, I'm obviously extremely transparent in everything I do. If I get something wrong, I'm 100% going to be accountable for that and be like, we're not getting that right. So he got up to, he said, how many of you guys are doing? I think it was like, what? You said 30 pieces of content a month, right?
Yeah, just one a day. That's it.
Yeah. So I want to tell you, bro, that like sparked something in me to like get off my ass and get more on Reels, on TikTok, on Facebook. And I can tell you, right now, I've been monitoring him daily, and we're at like between 12 and 15 pieces a day.
Nice. Hell
and
yeah.
That's Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, Snapchat, GMB. Like, you know, we haven't spun up Twitter yet, but that's coming next.
Yeah.
And, you know, YouTube, obviously. And I just want to, I appreciate you bringing that level of entrepreneurship and marketing to the table. And honestly, like, I personally feel targeted when I'm not doing what I'm supposed to do.
Yeah.
And yo, I didn't raise my hand when you asked 30 a month. And I was like, that changes. Like, I was on the horn. We were like, that night I was talking to my team, like, hey, you know, he's 100% right. He's 1,000% right. We're not doing 30 pieces a month. I want to do 30 pieces a day if we can scale to that. And that's what we're doing. And brother, we are seeing success right now with that strategy in real dollars, in real time, in a soft market. And it was due to that piece of advice, man. And I mean, I know Gary Vee talks about it too, but to have a peer talk about it and a peer doing business to customer, you know, cause that when I was listening to Gary Vee talk about that, I was like, oh, that doesn't pertain to me. And I'm not doing personal brand, yada, yada, yada. And then once we did implement that, you know, to see one of my peers doing so well, implementing that strategy, not going super hard in Google and seeing so much traction, respect, man. I appreciate that.
Thanks, man. Thanks.
Speaking
of
Gary Vee, you got to meet him, correct? Not too long ago?
Not yet. Not yet. Okay. My flights all got canceled for 2 days, bro. So I couldn't make it to New York, but I'm going up there, I think, in July to have a full deep day with him and his team. And I'm super excited to go do that.
Wow,
man, I might. What are the dates on that? You might have 50 under 50. And I love that.
Let's go, man.
I find a ton of value in those masterminds, and there is a ton of value. Look, if you go sit down with Gary Vee, and you're like, oh, this doesn't pertain to me because I'm not at Gary Vee's level. Well, guess what, homie? You know what I mean? You're probably never gonna be until you sit in a room with somebody smarter than you, and it's like, yo, I gotta take it right back to like soft selling the conference a little bit, because I mean, to the people that are complaining in this market right now, because of Justin and I's relationship and his direct advice, and he is operating at a higher level than I am, It's like, why wouldn't I take what he's saying to heart and implement it, man? So going down that path a little bit, you know, besides get up and go kayaking, besides your, you know, these other things that you're doing inside the water sports world, outside of that, I mean, what are your plans going into 23 and 24? I know you have some ostentatious goals, man.
Yeah. I mean, you know, inside the company, my hope is to grow, you know, another 5-10 locations in the next year. And outside the company, my goal is to push my personal brand to a whole new level. You know, I've been spending a lot of time, effort, and money on making that happen. You know, I've been putting out a lot of just content around what's been working for us, what hasn't been working, relationship building things. Like, I'm trying to grow my personal brand to a whole new level, that way beyond when the business is done, I'll have, you know, connections, I'll have a network, I'll have just a lot of things set up, you know, that I can see 5 years down the road, that if I'm not doing this now, when I potentially leave the business, what's next, you know? And if I spend the time and effort doing that stuff now, I could see that the what's next question gets answered a little bit easier when the end of the business comes. So I've just been, yeah, spending a lot of time doing that kind of stuff, trying to just do bigger picture things, you know, and spend less time on the little things that don't make a difference, whether that be in the business or the personal side of things. Like, I want to be doing these bigger things and spending less time on these mundane tasks that don't really seem to move the needle in my personal life or in the business, you know? So I'm really curious to like dig down the tunnel of doing longer form video on YouTube, I think is something really interesting. We talk so much about short form content that I think long form, there's still a space for it in the industry. And so I'm going to be spending a lot of time doing long form content. Rebooting the podcast. I haven't done an episode in like a year, but I've been lining up a bunch of guests and stuff for that as well. I think podcast is probably like the number one way that you can grow your personal brand. I haven't done an episode in a year, and I think it's probably the number one way that you can do it. So I really want to get back on that train and start working through those again, because I look to see what you guys are doing with this, and like, you know, however many episodes that you guys are in now, every single episode is you guys just creating a new connection. And before you know it, you guys have this web of like unlimited connections. If you have a question about accounting, if you have a question about marketing, if you have a question, you have someone's phone number, you could just text and get an answer. Whereas in the past, before you were doing this, it's like, you got to vet people, you got to pay for them, you got to, you know, and now you have all of these things that are right at your fingertips. So yeah, I applaud you guys for what you guys have done here, because it makes me look at it and say, damn, I need to be doing something like that, because I see all the connections happening. It's really cool.
Yeah, man. You know, to that point, I'm in a network, I'm in a paid network myself. I mean, just filled with guys that are trying to achieve what you're trying to achieve. And it's, I mean, it's an arduous road. And, you know, to that point, like, it's one of those things where I think you have to come into the podcast sphere completely organic, ask for nothing, expect nothing, make sure that you are the one. And you hear this term get thrown around a lot, but I don't truly think people understand it. And that is provide value, right? And it's like, Greg and I came out of the gate. We didn't really have a lot of people coming on. It was just him and I talking to our friends and not really trying to extract any value from them. Just giving them really advice, we tried to do this, like, you know, new people come in and we'll talk to them and give, because this is all we wanted to do was build community. And so in the podcast sphere, especially in the business podcast sphere, where I get everybody getting it wrong, is that it is such a soft sell. You can hear it, you can feel it, like you can see that there's an inverse of information being exchanged. So when we did start to bring on guests, such as yourself, such as people, it was this really exploratory. And again, like it wasn't like I was picking podcast guests like to extract information. It was like this free exchange of information and free exchange of value, because I was so hyper interested in what they had to say. And then it was like, Kevin, write this down. You know what I mean? Like, oh my God, I could do that. Like, holy, this is so neat. And I think we got really lucky where it was so organic and it was so, we, again, expect nothing, return nothing. And I'm still of the same mindset, whether it be the conference, whether it be sponsorships on the show. Greg doesn't give a shit. I don't give a shit. Don't, if we are selling something, cool, man, don't buy it. If we are trying to, you know, bring you on and have questions about your business, it's not just because it's going to help my business in particular, but like we had Patrick Coughlin on and we brought him on because he's so interesting. And we talked about marina management because this is a question in our industry. And through all this fun and through all the great exchange of ideas and conversation, I'm like, oh, let me ask you a question that not only pertains to the industry, but pertains to me personally. So, and again, it was an organic thing toward the end that just dawned on me that I didn't even bring him. We happened to have a meeting with our landlord, but it was very much pertaining to my situation. I'm like, hey, man, while I have you on, what do you think about this? Like, this is something I've got personally going on. And I think you can hear that throughout the entire show that it's not like, dude, I didn't bring you on to extract information to help myself. It really was just a last minute before you go, let me ask you this question. And it does help me, but also helps everybody else at large because we are all experiencing these sort of dynamics and these questions, these pain points, like as a collective audience. So if I can be any of advice to you going through into this, like the Facebook group has been extremely valuable as far as like building community. But I think you have to ask yourself as you promote this personal brand, as you promote those things, you know, it's like, what am I bringing to the table that maybe nobody else is, or bringing to the table in a way that nobody else is? And how am I fostering communal growth that doesn't benefit me in any way, shape, or form? And then just working that muscle week in and week out, day in and day out, so that you're just providing something to the marketplace that people truly need, if that makes sense.
You know? Yeah, yeah, 100%. No, I appreciate the advice. That's super helpful. I think there's a lot of room for growth, and like, you know, it's exciting for me to look ahead and just, you know, realize that, and some free value that I think I could give everyone like that listens to this podcast in the water sports space. When it comes to marketing, if you are not using Facebook Reels and YouTube Shorts right now, you're 1,000% missing out. Especially YouTube Shorts, because of how searchable the content is, and for years to come, if you're using keywords like Destiny and Water Sports and Destin and Crab Island and all of those things on YouTube Shorts, you're going to benefit from it like years down the road on YouTube Shorts. But Facebook Reels right now, the attention, they've been just pushing out the organic attention like mad. So if you're not actively on Facebook Reels and posting there every day, you're definitely missing out. We have like 38 million views already this year on Facebook Reels alone, just on one account, and we have 20 different accounts. So I haven't added up the other ones yet, but there is a lot of attention right now there, and I think people should be spending a lot of time there.
That was me writing down. I wasn't ignoring what you're saying. I'll actually put it in my notes to make sure, because I sometimes miss out on the Reels portion of it when we're running a lot of promos and doing a lot of different things, actually inside of groups.
Yeah.
That one of our marketing people are working on. So now I'm going to be like, hey, man, are we like, I know we're doing TikTok. I know we're doing, and I know Meta's cross connected. So if we are doing Instagram Reels, it is transferring over to Facebook Reels, but I just got to double check.
Have you guys seen that in the search results in Google? There's TikTok videos and there are YouTube Shorts now.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Hey, really quick, let me ask you a question, Justin, while we got you on. Like, what do your, like, so I have no idea other than like LinkedIn and Handshake and this stuff. Like, what, how do you, and obviously the Entrepreneur 40 Under 40, but like, what's your main hustle on marketing and selling your franchises for anybody that's interested?
Yeah, you're talking about like, where do I get the most action from, like the B2B side of of selling the business? Yeah. Up to this point, I had spent $0 on marketing the franchise side of the business. All of the franchisees had been friends and family or previous tour guides or friends of any of the franchisees. But we're seeing now, like I've been getting a bunch of leads organically through the website. And a lot of them are customers that have done our business before. The tour guide tells them that we're a franchise and then they're more interested and they had a good time and they want to do it themselves. Or it's just people looking around for outdoor recreation franchises and they come across, you know, my business and that's how that's worked out. But from this point forward, I'm now spending more money and, or spending any money. I pulled out an ad in that Entrepreneur magazine that we were featured in for like top new and emerging franchise, which was like over $10,000 to do, you know, a full page ad in. I'm starting to do like Google ads for it. I've been doing just organic LinkedIn posts and talking about it more on my own socials. But I think like from here forward, I need to triple down on how do I get the word out about like, this is a thing, this is happening. And we're opening, all of our locations have been in Florida. So a lot of the incoming interest has been people in Florida. But we're opening a Tennessee location next week. And then we're opening a Texas location in 2 weeks. And then hopefully a Hawaii location this summer. So now that it's like going outside of Florida, I think that a lot more attention will be coming from those areas and more people will be taking this seriously across the board. I think a lot of people think that you can only do clear kayaks in super clear water, but what they don't realize is if you offer a clear kayak at the same place that you offer a yellow kayak at the same exact price, and you're getting a better experience out of the clear kayak, 9 out of 10 people or 10 out of 10 people are going to book the clear kayak because it's more fun. We have the branding, we have the 21,000 reviews, and we've really fine-tuned the experience. So like if I can offer it at the same price that someone down the road can offer it and we're in a clear kayak and they're not, who's to say that, you know, more people shouldn't just be utilizing the clear kayaks. So I think like as we expand, more people are going to see that and use it in places that maybe they didn't think it was as feasible. And so I think our numbers speak for themselves, you know, and when people really get into the franchise process and see that, they're very surprised at what we've been able to accomplish over the last, you know, few years.
Have you done any formal sales training?
I have not. No, I am much more of a marketing person than a salesperson. But I'm in the mindset of like, I think if you can build a brand, people will come and the sales will happen naturally. And if Nike never built a brand, would their shirts be $60, you know, and would people buy them just because it has a check mark on it? And so I think like as I continue to grow the brand, more people will come, more people will see it. I'll continue to get these big press articles. I'll continue to get shows like The Bachelor, Teen Mom, Discovery Channel. We're on a TripAdvisor's coming out this Thursday to come do a documentary that's going to be on like Amazon Prime. We're doing a lot of things just from the brand that I've built and not having to do any sales focused things. So I do think there is a space for the sales side of it, but I think like
Nike
we've accomplished so much.
They do. They do. So does Amazon. They all have a sales department. And look, man,
they do.
I go into my sales network group and I bang the drum about marketing. They just look at me like I'm drunk or something, like marketing, you know, what do you mean marketing? You know, I'm like, oh my God. And then I come into Arival and I beat the drum on sales because your department, all those departments, teams are called sales and marketing. Now it's probably switching to marketing and sales as that sort of, you know, that push becomes inverse as marketing does become more of a focus, these things grow. But I think for the B2B side, I think it's so important. Do you follow Alex Hormozi?
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Okay. Yeah, man. Well, I think he's a great guy in the space that talks about sales, and his presentations on sales are amazing. We do have like a small room presentation in Arival this year on sales and drilling down, but I've been hard pitching Douglas because of the same thing, because in the Arival crowd, no one seems to give a shit about sales. And because I've seen it work on my side so well, and because we've seen top and bottom line growth, even to this point of the last episode, Steve talking about like when he drilled down on me about being less of an order taker and less of a, because I agree with you, like Amazon, Microsoft, Nike, all these like have great marketing, but at the same point in time, like they do have great enterprise sales, and there's a reason why. Because at the same point in time, you need your marketing efforts and everything you're doing to be backed up by that sales when people have questions. And so I think in the B2B space, I don't think I know how important sales truly are.
And to this whole point, man, like, I'm glad to hear that you're embracing the paid side of things, because it truly is important, to scale. And then the second piece of this is, like, I wouldn't be doing my job if I didn't, like, ask you, like, why you're not a sponsor of the show, why you're not a sponsor of the forum, because I think you get so much more, or even a rival to this point. Like, they're a little bit more pricier than we are. Close your ears, Bruce, but they're also pitching to, you know, 10 times the demographic that we are at the forum. Yeah. But to this point, I feel like our forum, our group, you know, this is like, right, this is sales, and all of these people that are inside of it are definitely warm, hot leads that are super interesting. Like, we, you and I got on a call about Clear Kayaks, and because of your demeanor, because of the way you are, because you're not, you like don't want to hard sell a friend or whatever it was, like, you know, your sales were shit, dude. Like, I mean, not to be a jerk, and I promised I was going to be super positive to you. But, yeah. No, I mean, it's just like, you know, like, if I called, like, you know what I mean? Like, there should have been follow-up. It's like, I think realistically, if this went up the pipe or really down the pipe outside of my purview into my team or whatever, and there was follow-up on there, I think they probably would have came back and been like, this is a, like, we need to get on this. Like, I think this seems like a good deal. And if my team is like 100% with it, then I'm 100% with it because I trust their judgment. But because there's no follow-up, because this didn't happen, there is no Clear Kayaks or get up and go kayaks at Destiny Water Adventures. And I think it would have been like an advantageous partnership, you know, and to this whole point, I see what works. I hunt down whatever. I'm a busy guy like you are. So, you know, because all this stuff didn't happen, it's like we don't have get up and go kayaks in this market. And all this to this point of being a good salesman, and I'm just, again, a value exchange, whatever, take it with it what you will. Like, you know, as I told the first person I told about the conference, I pitched to him on sponsorships, take it, leave it, don't do anything with it. But I think it would be, and I always wondered, I was like, why doesn't Justin sponsor the podcast? And then right back to us, we're terrible salesmen ourselves. We're not going to beat down, you know what I mean? Well, I'm not going to beat down your door for something that I know that's good for you, but I'm trying to get better at this. So it's a conversation that we should probably, you know, have in the future. And I'm just going to do it right on the show and, like, sales, whatever. This is what I tell everybody, is to, like, ask for the sale, dude. So it's like, man, are you going to be a sponsor of the show or the event in the future?
I appreciate all of that. You know, I always look at, like, what I'm good at and what I'm not good at, and I try to hire for what I'm not good at and or don't like doing. And so I don't like, and I'm not good at, the sales side of things. So I have hired a team of people that do the sales side of franchising, which maybe you'll be glad to hear. The second part of it is, as far as sponsoring goes, I think I can get my personal brand to a level where everyone in the water sports industry knows who I am. And I don't think, I don't feel like I need to pay to make that happen. I think I can just make that happen if I continue the path that I'm going down and continue to put out the content and do X, Y, and Z. I do think paying could get me there a little bit quicker. And I do think using these platforms like the Awkward Water Sports podcast and Arival and things like that could, tourpreneur, could help. But I'm making some strategic moves in the background that I think will get me there by myself. And I don't know what it is, but, like, I always just feel a level of accomplishment if I can, like, do it myself and not have to rely on other people. And so that's where I'm at with it, is, like, I think, like, with everything that I have going on, I will be able to get my brand in front of every single water sports operator that there's already out there. And there is some things happening in the background with Arival and Fair Harbor that I think I may be able to do something similar to what Kai Capro did, at last Arival.
Yeah. He sponsored the show.
Yeah. He does sponsor the show. Yeah. And, the dude is very smart. So, this is what I do, is I let other people do these things before me. I ask how they go, and then I see if I should do something similar.
Oh, okay. There we go.
So
that's smart.
I don't like to necessarily be the guinea pig on things, but
so
I like
basically
to...
basically saying Kai's bad-mouthing us.
No. I haven't talked to him at all about it, but I will. That's my point, is Like I like to see how other people do with things. And then if I see that it's working, I'll do it. You know, I'm not necessarily the first mover on things like this, but I feel like I'm the smart mover on things like this. So
I would agree.
It'll happen.
Let me ask you this. Like, would you have wanted to be the first mover on Ethereum?
Ethereum, yes. But if you asked me one of the other billion coins that never went anywhere, no, you know, it's like,
we got to wrap it up. But Justin, Justin, can you just end the show? Tell us, like, what would you tell someone that's like brand new? They're getting into this. They're like, okay, there's all these influencers and people in that Facebook group, or, you know, they're doing big things. Like, how do I get my piece? Like, how do I get some limelight?
Yeah, I think part of it is just like looking in the industry and seeing who's actually doing it and pulling pieces from what they're doing and making it your own, right? And so see what I'm doing with social media, but see what Kevin's doing with sales. 100%. And Kevin's been crushing it with the phone sales conversations. And I remember at the last Watersports forum, you know, hearing him talk about the phone script, and like, to his point, he went home and did the marketing thing. I went home and read up on our script, right? And so I think like everyone, when you're just starting out, you have to look around in the industry, see what is seemingly working, and then just pull pieces from all of those people. And one of the biggest things that I always tell like my new franchisees is that reviews are likely the most important part of growing your business in any given market. If you have two reviews, it's not likely that you're going to get much business. If you have 500 reviews, it's a lot more likely that you're going to get business. So I think like the biggest place that people need to focus on is how do they convert more people for reviews, and how do they engage more people in general? And then probably to Kevin's point, how do you close those people once you engage them, right? So you just have to find like what works for you, and don't be afraid to try new things. Like we have the stickers program that we do at all of our locations. You get a free sticker, and it kind of makes the customer feel like they got to give you something back. And it's worked really well for us when it comes to things like tipping and getting reviews and that kind of thing. And we also have a loyalty program. So I think like doing those types of things and trying new things, seeing what works, seeing what doesn't work, and pulling from the people that are seemingly actually doing it is where you're going to find the most value and the most bang for your buck when it comes to just starting out.
Big facts. And listen, and to all this point, man, like all of the things that we're talking about on the personal level, dude, like I would like your sales team to reach out to us. And here's just a good piece of advice. If you don't already know this, like June and July is the time, you know what I'm saying? Like everyone flush with cash June and July. Right. Oh, now yeah. You call me up and you're like, hey man, let's like get on some franchise shit. I'm going to be like, dude, hold on, man. You know what I mean? Like I just took a bath on crypto. The market's soft. Just breathe, man. Breathe, Kevin. It's cool. We have some money in the bank, but I would say like, yeah, man, like reach out, like let's get our people connected, because I truly would. I like when I think about Get Up and Go Kayak and I think about what y'all are doing, like the cross promotional stuff that could happen between Destiny and Get Up and Go. Like I think that's, you know, I think that's a slam dunk. I also think the same slam dunk happens between the Get Up and Go Kayaking and Awkward Water Sports guys. So it's like, if we do business together, like, yo, let's do it across the board and be successful the whole way. Right. Because that's how I always do business. And off air, man. And like if any of these resources, like I want to know more about the stuff that you're doing on the personal brand side, Gary V, and I can plug you into the network that I pay to be in that's really about these sales, because I think as entrepreneurs, man, we've got to be dialed into both, because I think one master serves the other one, marketing and sales. And you know what I mean? I don't look at them as being segregated, dude. I look at them as being intertwined. You know what I'm seeing? Mm-hmm. Then we hit that shit like a sledgehammer on both sides of the fence and it's a home run for everybody, dude.
Oh yeah. Yeah, I appreciate it. Yeah.
I swear to God, I did not plan on pitching you live on the show.
No, you're good.
I did think about pitching Kai on a sponsorship when I did a sales presentation for his people. So the Colonel was back there. I never actually did it because there was so much to unpack with his people. But I was like, you know what, man, I'm actually gonna do this right now and to see how it pans out, dude. And you gave me a lot of good feedback that when I go to a sponsorship that I don't know, that I'm going to be like, hey, here's what we can offer. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
And it's going to be filled with lies. Dirty salesman.
All right. Well, hey.
Justin, how can people get a hold of you, man, if they want to become franchise partners or besties?
Yeah. If you want to be besties, I mean, my personal brand is probably the best place for that. So J_Buzzi, B-U-Z-Z-I is my socials for all of that. And then the business brand is Get Up and Go Kayaking. So obviously just www.getupandgokayaking.com or on socials at Get Up and Go Kayaking. You can find everything about franchising, myself, the personal brand, the business brand, all of that stuff there. So I definitely would recommend checking that out, reading a little bit more about the franchise side of things and the business and see what we're doing. And yeah, I'm looking for adventurous people that are willing to take a little bit of a risk, but also a calculated risk with me on their side. So I'm looking forward to expanding into different places.
Same. Yes, sir.
All right, Justin, we appreciate you coming on. And as always, keep it awkward.